Hello, everybody. Welcome to Design 113. This is week 3. Can you believe we're here already? I think the time flies by a little too fast sometimes, but for better or for worse, this is week 3, which means next week we're going to actually be talking about the final project and our final grades. So this will be a fun ride. Hey, welcome. Thanks for coming. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to go ahead and turn off my video real quick so that we can start the slides. Okay, we had some technical difficulties last week, so I'm hoping that this actually records, so do apologize. Okay, how are you, Liz? Thanks for coming. Pull up the chat box here. All right, so how did week two, we're on week three. How did week two go for you? Pretty good? Good. All right. Well, this week we're going to be talking about setting type. Last week we talked about typography and rules. And we've got some more rules that we're going to be talking about. But this assignment, I don't know if you've looked ahead to this next assignment. If you loved last week, you are going to love this week's. This week's assignment is actually really fun, and I love teaching this assignment. We're going to be learning how to create portraits out of the characters. The letters, and there are some really cool artists out there who actually do this stuff very well, and so we're going to kind of admire their work a little bit this week, and we're also going to try to mimic it. So we'll go over some examples with that. So before we jump into that, though, I do want to share, let's go to the quizzes. One second. Oops, apologize. Let's share the screen here. And sorry, I don't know why it's not letting me share the, there we go. There's the quizzes. Okay, so let's jump into week 3. Have you done the quiz for this, for today, Liz?
Yes.
Okay, perfect. Then we will just move on to tomorrow's. Let's just do Wednesday. Let's move on to Wednesday. Here we go. All right. Oh, you know what? I'm in the wrong class. Sorry. It's hard keeping them straight sometimes. Okay, so now we'll move on to week 3, Wednesday. So we're already almost in the middle of the week, which means Wednesday we'll have the deadline of being able to, you'll have to post your initial post for the discussion. So make sure you get that in before 11:59 p.m. on Wednesday. Okay, this is a tuition question. As a graduate, when will the interest start on my educational plan loan if I have one? Well, let's look for those words. Educational plan, 30, 60, 90, or 15 days. I think that it'll be 90. Is interest? What do you think? Should we choose it and see what we get? Okay, so it's 90 days. Let's try another one. Be Thursday. So you have a video to watch, and these videos are pretty interesting, so make sure that you watch that. Blank, typefaces are similar in appearance. Avoid typefaces that are similar. Only use typefaces that are similar. Remove or align typefaces that are similar. I would say avoid. I'm not quite sure. I haven't watched the video. We'll say avoid. So if you're trying to create contrast in your design, you want two different ones. So if you're using a sans serif, all capital letters, then you'll probably want to use a lowercase serif font to add some contrast to that. So you definitely want to look for the different fonts when you're trying to add emphasis. And we learned that in our design for the flyer. All right, let's do Fridays and we'll move on. Hey, welcome. Thanks for coming, Calvin. And Calvin, or sorry, Alvin, sorry, if you want to turn off your camera, that way. There we go. Okay. All right, so let's do this next one. Use typefaces that are wider width for readability. What do you think? Is that true or false? Oh, that's okay, Alvin. I don't know why it's defaulting to that, so. Any guesses? False from Liz? Use typefaces that are wider for width. Okay, well, let's see. Well, there's a lot of things that can go into readability, but that's correct. It's false. I believe serif fonts are the best fonts to use for readability because those serifs add those little extra lines that kind of guide the eye as you read heavy amounts of text. So it's important if you have a large amount of text to use serif fonts to help. That's why you'll see in magazines or even newspapers, when you see articles or read articles, the headline might be in a sans serif font, but the actual body text is in a serif font. Just easier to read. Okay, enough of the quizzes. We'll stop there. And let's go back to PowerPoint. Hey, we have a lot to cover today, so we're gonna kind of skim through this and we're actually get to the fun part, which is the design portion. So for the first hour, we'll be going over this, just a few slides. So let's talk about this. When we were designing our flyer, I gave you guys some feedback when I was going grading. Some of you were able to submit some pretty awesome designs, so I'm so proud of what I got to see. And we're going to talk about legibility a little bit. So this is the type, there are some questions that you want to ask yourself. Hey, thanks for coming. Just make sure that, I don't know why it's, is it Arthur? Go ahead and turn off your cam. There you go. Not sure why it's defaulting to that. So everybody who signs in, it kind of goes, let's hide that video panel. There we go. All right. But welcome. Thanks for coming. Thanks, Liz. I appreciate it. Okay. All right, let's jump into this. Let me get my slides that, let me get my notes. Okay, so for optimum legibility, I want you to choose classical time-tested typefaces. Now, we talked about one in particular last week. Do you remember which one we talked about? There was a movie made out of it. Hey, Tamara, go ahead and turn off your cam. Everyone who's signing in, for some reason, it's defaulting to the video. I'm not sure how to turn that off. I'm going to look and see if I can figure out in the settings real quick. Just give me a second. Let's deal with video settings. Not quite sure. No, we all want to see everybody, don't we? It just gets a little bit distracting when all the videos are on. There we go. Everyone's turned off. Perfect. Okay. We love everybody, right? Everybody's welcome. All right. So let's talk about legibility. So for optimum legibility, to read something very clearly, you need to choose classical, time-tested typefaces. We talked about one last week. Does anyone? Okay, I saw Tamara. She said Helvetica. Now, these typefaces should be drawn and crafted with consistency among characters, and it needs to be highly legible proportion. So if you're designing a typeface, these would be things to keep in mind. Readability. Does the quality of the page make it easy to read? That's a question you need to ask yourself. Is it inviting? Does it make me want to read more? Is it pleasurable to the eye? So those are some things to think about. Baskerville. There's a font called Bembo, Bodoni, Caslon, Centaur, Franklin Gothic, Futura, Garamond, Helvetica, News Gothic, Times New Roman, and Universe. These are all fonts that are pretty classic examples. I have a video here that I want to share, so we're going to go into the video portion of this. Less of me, more video. Pull up a video real quick. Bear with me one second as I hang on. We're experiencing a severe lag. I am so sorry. I think it's kind of wigging out today. All right, can you guys see this? I'm gonna pause it real quick. Can you hear it? Is the sound coming through? There we go. How's the sound? How was it? Were you able to hear it? Can you hear it? Good? Okay.
Which is here. This PDF uses some clever gibberish text, which is generated from, there are several websites you can go to plug in keywords, and it will randomly generate gibberish sentences. So it's kind of fun to look at. But here, it's been used just for the type treatments. The first one is done in an Old English, Old Style typeface. Now, generally speaking, this is considered somewhat illegible because it's so decorative and it's so heavy and condensed. However, the treatment here is not that bad. You'll notice that it is great contrast, black on white. The line length is a little bit long. I would have made it shorter, but you'll notice that it has some decent leading. So this is actually something that is readable. So if you ever had to use this typeface, knowing that spacing around the letters is of prime importance, as is a short line length and a good contrast. The next couple paragraphs use sans serif and serif, respectively, for the same treatment. And it looks like they're the same size. And you can see the differences in the two serif and sans serif. And the sans serif one looks a little larger. So I would say for better readability, the type size on this one could go down, but I would keep the same leading. And as with all of these, I think the line lengths are a tad too long, and I would make them shorter for just for better readability. But generally speaking, these two are pretty good for readability. The next couple are not. The bold, the all caps, not as easily read. The bold gets dark. It has a dark text color, as we say. It's not bad in some ways because it's upper and lower case. It's got decent leading. But we try to avoid that in body copy. Bold is just too much. All caps, you can hopefully immediately see that this is tough to read. All the letters are the same height. It just makes it, and the long line length doesn't add to this. So we do avoid bold and all caps in paragraph text. The next sections are what we call reversed text, any text that is lighter than its background. Now, this can be a very effective treatment for headlines, for subheads, for really short passages, but even for something this long, no, it's too much. It makes the eyes tired after a while. And here, in this example, which uses the font Papyrus, you'll notice that the ascenders and descenders are starting to bump into one another, which says that the leading is not deep enough, and this would need to be reset. And some designers feel, by the way, that the font Papyrus is so overused that it's a good one to avoid anyway. This next one is quite good. It's a light gray, green background with black text, and I think generally that is a readable type treatment. Here we have the same green background, but not so readable. The bold here, the thin typeface here, notice that it's set in gray, very difficult to read, and this one is horrible. Not only is it all caps and bold, it's a condensed typeface that is practically completely illegible. So we want to avoid the decorative fonts treatment on paragraphs. And here's another example. A really cool looking digital font, very modern, but not in this treatment. Really tough to read, okay? Now here's an interesting example. This is a very small point size and it's kind of hard to read on the left, but the same size type is a lot easier to read on the right because of the leading. The leading has been probably tripled in depth and it's really still quite small. But you'd agree, I think, that it would be a lot easier to read this on the right. So if you ever have to use small point size on your text, make the leading as deep as possible for ease of reading. Next, we have an example of how text that's overly large is really tough to read, as you can quickly see. It's tiring. Here are some great examples of what not to do. Gray text on a light green background, really tough. And then my personal favorite, the busy background. You can't read that text at all. It is just impossible. Here's one solution, and that is to take the same background and ghost it back, make it a lot lighter, and then the text is much more contrasty on top of that. Lastly, I went over these in another video, but we'll repeat them here again. This is the same paragraph set in different alignments. This is flush left, and this is justified. Each of these two top ones are really quite readable and work quite well in layouts. If you work with the word spacing on the justified so you don't get the holes in the text, you can be quite successful with these two settings. Flush right, which is here, and centered don't work as well for body copy. The rags are just too distracting. So you want to avoid those two settings for long passages. This is something to be aware of if you use text wrap here, where you wrap text around a graphic. You should really use a justified type alignment when you're wrapping text around something, because you'll get a straight line on the edges and you'll get a much cleaner line around your text wrap, around your graphic, if you use justified. This is flush left, rag right, and so you get a super raggedy left side there. Okay? This is a border text treatment. Be careful with how you use these because they can be hard to read, but if you ever do use it, I recommend an all caps version so the letters are all the same size. Makes for a better border. Lastly, we have a nice treatment here, a block of text on its side. This can work really well if you use a justified alignment, get rid of any gaps in the word, word spacing, and you use good contrast and a nice readable typeface. And then at the end here, we have some not so readable because it's gray on green. The black reads a lot better over the green background. I'm going to finish here with a fun example of something that a student sent me a couple years ago. I have never been able to figure out what this says. I think it's probably a logo for a band, a death metal band, and it's a case where the letters have been overly treated, and it's just absolutely impossible to read. So do show some restraint when working with logo text, and keep these readability tips in mind as you proceed. Thanks.
All right, so what did you guys learn? What are some things that you picked up on? Go ahead and pause that. So what did you hear? What were the, I guess we'll start with what not to do. What not to do. Yeah, so when it comes to body copy, there were some rules, right? Body copy is the large amounts of text that you have in a book or a magazine, a flyer, or a newspaper. So yeah, don't use too many fonts. That's been the rule. How many fonts are you supposed to use generally when you're designing something? Two. Good job, Tamara. Yeah, two. So I would say three max, but that's only if you're a seasoned designer, you know what you're doing. Even now I use two. I just don't like, it just can get too muddled, too confusing, too much going on. We don't need all the fanfare. We just need two fonts, right? And in the body copy, just like Liz said, no bold. Yeah, no bold condense. That's really hard to read. So, yeah, 23 fonts. That's the rule, right? Yeah, and no centering fonts. So in your flyer design, if you had a tendency to center all of your content, you might want to ask yourself, how can you design something, challenge yourself to design something off of the centered alignment? Because if you kind of don't want to get in that habit. Not everything can be centered. You don't want to have every layout you design be centered. So try to challenge yourself a little bit. All right, good job. So we were talking a little bit about how we read, right? And we talked about the classic rules. So reading in the eyes, it's important to understand how it works. I don't even know how to pronounce this word, this I'm not going to even try. This movement is a series of jerky movements followed by fixation pauses. So the example here that I give you is Read a group of words within one eye span, then pause and shift the eyes to another group of words. And that's kind of the idea of how things are read. Regression, it's a process of rereading material to find keywords in previous lines. This is thought to help the people with short-term memory and to make continuous connections within the material. So is that how you spell it? Okay. Saccadic movement? Okay. Got it. Thank you. So factors for determining readability. Type size is important. You want a line, column width. This is all important as well. Horizontal flow created by the white space between your lines. Readers don't read individual letters. They read words, and they read groups of words based on things that they can associate with in the past. So it's important to kind of shape the words a little bit. Now, youth versus adults, there's a difference. So adults read entire words and phrases rather than piecing together individual letters. We read young readers, so that's R-A-T, rat, right? Adults, rat versus R-A-T, readability versus readability. So when I put this up here, it's different. Lowercase versus uppercase. And what she talked about in the video was that you shouldn't do all uppercase when you're doing large bodies of text, right? You want to keep them lowercase. So there's a few rules, like I told you about. Optimum legibility, you want to choose classic timeless typefaces. I listed a few for you. Also, we want to be sure that these typefaces are drawn, that they're consistent. Stretching, squishing text is a bad, bad, bad thing. No, don't ever, ever do it, okay? To resize fonts proportionately, you'll have to either go manually adjust it, or you can hold down shift as you shrink, or shift an option as you shrink down the text box, okay? You want to choose a font that's designed to fit your purpose. So just like when we were designing our logos, if it's a bank, you probably want something that's a little bit more corporate looking, a little bit more professional, rather than a toy company, right? The toy company can use more of a chill font, more of a relaxed font, which is a little bit more fun, kind of exudes some lightheartedness. But you would never use that kind of a font for a toy company as you would for a bank, because then people wouldn't take that bank very seriously. And to be honest, I don't know if I trust them with my money. So it's very important that you choose a font that communicates a message, what that brand is all about. So avoid unintentional distorting fonts when you're resizing. Do it the correct way and use the correct tools, and also within the text boxes as well. All right, so upper and lowercase. Let's talk about text set. So text set, all capital letters, severely retards the reading, just like we saw in the video. You want to use upper and lowercase letters for optimum readability. Ascenders and descenders, which are they're like serifs, but they're the length and height of the letters themselves. These provide the necessary visual cues to make text more readable. So text set entirely in uppercase letters, they kind of form a monotonous rectangular shape. Uppercase letters can successfully be used in display type, like headlines, anything above 16 points. Because by then the font is readable, or I guess legible enough, you can read it, it's large enough that despite how fancy it is or how different it is, you'll be able to make out what it is. So that's kind of the rule of thumb, is anything above 16 points, then you can use uppercase letters. But for body copy, which is usually 8 points or less, you definitely want to use something that's not all caps. All right. You can definitely, there are times where you can use this to your advantage, like we talked about, the headlines, subheadlines. And then switching cases, an example of all caps uses, this is a good example of kind of adding contrast. So all caps are nice when you want to make something stand out. Usually when you're texting someone or you're emailing someone or anything on social media, when you use all caps, it's like someone yelling at you. And so that's kind of the same stigma that we have for all caps. So we don't want to use it too much, especially in body copy. We want to use it to create emphasis, catch someone's attention. All right, so next rule. So for text type, you want to use sizes that, here's an example of this rule. So speaking of lowercase and uppercase, the variation, if you can see, in the shape of the block, this keeps the eye from tiring. So you can kind of see how hard it is to read. This is just an example. All right, let's move on. So for text type, you want to use sizes according to the legibility studies. They prove most readable. So studies have been shown that the sizes generally range from 8 point to 12 points for text, and this is read from an average distance of about 12 to 14 inches. So be sure to remember that sizes based on the X height of letters appear different from one typeface to another. Yeah, and in this case, it's saying no more than 12 point. Yeah. So these sizes generally range to about 8 to 12 point, and then you want about 12 to 14 inches kind of distance to see if it's legible. So just be sure to remember that all sizes appear different from one typeface to another. So a 12 point Times New Roman will look maybe a little smaller than a 12 point Sans Serif Arial or something like that. So different fonts will kind of look larger or smaller depending on, they're not all consistent across the board. Yeah, and 12 points is always safe, I guess, for most things. But when you're working with body copy, you want to kind of stick around the 8-point font just because that is probably the most common. 8 to 9, you never want to go larger than 9 for body copy. For headlines, hey, anything goes. You can make it as large as you want, and we want it large. Kind of like your flyer design. The larger the headline, the better off it looked, the more it stood out. But when it came to the body copy, it didn't need to be that large. So kind of stick to 8 or 9. Generally is the rule for the body copy. Whoops. Right? So rule 7. So use text types of book weight for copy. So you want to avoid typefaces appearing too heavy or too light, just like we saw in that video where she showed the bold condensed was way too heavy and it was too hard to read. Text typefaces that are too light cannot easily be distinguished from their background. So if they're too light and too narrow, too skinny, too thin, it's going to kind of blend in with the white background and be very hard to read. You're going to have to strain to read it or to try to make out what it's saying. So in typefaces that are too heavy, counterforms diminish in size, so making them less legible is what's going on. So you want to make sure that you aren't using too heavy, too light. It's kind of like the Goldilocks and the Three Bears. You don't want anything like too hot or too cold. You just want it in the middle, just right. Whoops, skipping ahead here. All right, where am I? Okay. We just did that one. We did this one. Yeah, so when in doubt, you want to stick with a regular or Roman weight for the copy, for a body copy especially. Okay, let's do the next one. So for a text type, you want to use consistent letter and word spacing to produce something that's even, uninterrupted, texture and color. Letters should flow really gracefully, and you want it natural. And so that's the idea here. You want natural words flowing into the lines. This means that the word spacing should increase proportionately as letter spacing increases. So again, she said that, you know, if you adjusted the leading between the sentences, that gave it a little bit more breathing room. If you aligned something to write to justify, then you'd need to adjust the word spacing so that everything looked a little bit more proportionate. So there's always going to be some adjustments. Default fonts and spacing is not always going to work out to your benefit. So you do need to go in and know how to manually adjust. So next rule we've got here, rule 11. So you want to adjust subheadings to have a closer proximity. You want tighter line spacing, and basically you want a closer proximity to the paragraph, and same with the associated paragraph that's either going to be before it or following after it. So even spacing will make connections unclear. So again, we kind of talked about a few weeks ago, proximity was one of those things we need. Depending on how much space, something could be segregated or not a part of a group, or it could be part of a group, just depending on the proximity of the elements, right? So if you have a group of dots, you'll know that based on their spacing, they're meant to be in a cluster. But the more spread out they get, the more it's hard to determine if this is what it is. Any questions so far? Okay, it's pretty straightforward. It's just good to know the rules before you go in and start designing something. You want to start for consistent rhythmic regs. That's the, that's either the indent before or after the words. So the purpose of effective regs is not only to achieve aesthetic beauty, what I mean by that is it's visually pleasing or easy to read, but to enable readers to move gently and effortlessly down a text column. This allows the eye, it doesn't strain the eyes. It allows it to flow very nicely. Effective regs consist of lines establishing an informal but really consistent pattern of line endings. So down here, why does it keep doing that? So down here, I made it a note that you've got to adjust those styles. Let's see what rule we have, 14. There you go. You gotta adjust the tracking, the letting, the hyphenation options, even the indents on a sentence. So we've got to be aware of how it's lined up. So when in doubt, I usually say align bodies of text, left justify. We learned that right justify doesn't translate. Even the right alignment with the left rags, that doesn't translate either. So you want left justify is usually a good one to use. Okay, next one. You want to clearly indicate paragraphs. Be careful not to upset the integrity and the visual consistency of the text, though. The two most common ways of indicating paragraphs are by indenting and inserting additional space between paragraphs. Sometimes people even use drop caps, and this can kind of mess up the formatting a little bit. So you need to be careful when you're using anything that's kind of outside the norm. Anything that will shift your lines or words or the spacing, you need to make sure that you go back and manually adjust it so that it's not an awkward default spacing. So only choose one type of indication to keep the text flowing. Limit drop or enlarged caps, like drop caps, or to the beginning of the paragraph only. So if you are going to use it, please only use it sparingly. And it's usually only, a drop cap is only used usually in magazines for the first paragraph of an article. They never usually duplicate it again. If you do see it, then it's more of an amateur move. So probably rule of thumb is just do it once. And you don't do it on flyers usually. This is for large bodies of text. So you can show where the next, where the paragraph or the article starts. Usually found in a magazine quite often and newspapers too. All right, last rule, rule 18. So always align letters and words on the baseline. Letters are designed to coexist side by side on an invisible baseline. So there's kind of this invisible line that you're lining up letters and words on, and baseline is either the flush left or the flush right. So text on a path, she talked a little bit about typing in text on a path. You see that octagon she created. This should be used with skill and a purpose. So don't just do it because you think it looks cool to put something on. It's very hard to read. So you do need to make sure that you are doing it consistently. Oftentimes you'll see text on a path when you're doing a circular logo and you want the text to go all the way around, or you want to position it a certain way. That's when you would use it, but basically don't use it for large bodies of text. It doesn't translate. Okay. Any questions with those rules that we just went over? Okay, pretty straightforward again. So just remember, bolded body copy, all caps, body text. This is very hard to read. Bolded body copy is too heavy. Scripted fonts, we learned, are used as all caps. Very hard to read. Other common problems, vertically stacked text. When you stack things too much on the vertical, like a tower, it doesn't translate. Body text is too large. Over 12 point is too much. So remember, 8 to 12 point is where you want to stick. You never want to go too large. Outline body text, just don't ever do it, okay? That's why it's in blue. Don't outline or give it a stroke is what it's saying. Don't give it a stroke. Too many effects used on the text, like blur or shading, gradients, blends, bubbles, shadows, anything like that. You don't put effects on the text of a body in the flyer. Now, when is it appropriate to use these effects? a good question. You can use it in the headline, maybe. You can use it in the design, kind of the supporting elements on the design, but you never want to use it for large bodies of text or paragraphs of text, I should say. So these are the don'ts. Don't do these. Other common problems. First line indenting is too large. It looks like there's a huge gap there. Inconsistent spacing after paragraphs. This is also a problem, especially when you're doing different alignments. Another one that's important to remember is if the text is too close to the edge of the page. I see this very often. In fact, when I was grading, so I want you to take a look at your flyer and ask yourself, is the text too close to the page? I usually like to give myself about half an inch around my page where my text box stands. So I never want the text to be touching the edge of the page, because when you send it to the printer, things will get cropped or cut off. And so as a designer, you want to make sure you give yourself a safety zone. So I usually give myself about half an inch around an 8.5 by 11. If that was the, you'll probably have to adjust it a little bit, maybe a quarter of an inch, but you want to give yourself even spacing all around. Okay. You can use your rulers and smart guides to help you with that. You're exhausted. Try talking for 2 hours, then you'll really be exhausting. Text too close to other items or text boxes, graphics, pictures. So text is unreadable over the background. And here's the good news, guys. We're going over the do's and don'ts of the text, but we're going to be breaking all rules for our assignment now. So that's the fun part, is once you learn the rules, you can then try to break them a little bit. Let's talk about punctuation. Just as important as any styling of body text or text in itself, punctuation is huge. That's why we, as designers, we may not be English majors, but you will be graded on spelling and grammar. Punctuation is very important. So let's look at these two sentences. So let's eat, Grandma. Is that what we're having for dinner? Or let's eat, Grandma, inviting her to join. So there are two different ways. And just by using that comma alone, it changed the definition of what was being said. Okay. Liz, you asked why, what? Did you have a question? Well, why eat, Grandma? Why? Hey, let's not eat, Grandma. Okay. She's a good person. Let's invite her to eat with us and use that comma. Okay. So, just based off of a comma alone, we can, in and out, there is no period at the end of these sentences. So even then we would need to add something. So let's be aware of that. It would look very, you'll look like an amateur to your clients or to your employer if you're not using correct punctuation, if things aren't stylistically correct, or grammar isn't correct, or spelling is a huge thing. And there's spell check, so there's really no reason to miss out on that. So punctuation and special characters. So this is when your type knowledge is going to really show, or it might not show. Use your appropriate marks. Thinking with type. I have some glyphs I want to show you, so I'll get that ready. Use glyphs when available. Practice sensitive typography, language, specific characters, and accents. So what's a glyph? Do you guys know what glyphs are? Glyphs are kind of like a library book of extra characters within a font family. Not all are created the same. So Times New Roman will have different glyphs than maybe Arial. Some will have more than others. So you've probably used glyphs a little bit. I want to show you real quick, see if this will come up. The website called Thinking with Type, and I wanted to introduce it to you a little bit. So a well-designed comma carries the essence of the typeface down to its delicious detail. So Helvetica's comma, this is a chunky square mounted to a jaunty curve. So you can see these little glyphs, these little characters. So designers and editors really need to learn various typographic conventions, in addition to mastering grammatical rules and punctuation. But as you can see, there's lots of different characters. These are numbers, numerals. Let's go down to the glyphs. Let me do a search. There we go. So just lots of different characters that you can choose from, and I'll show you through, I'll show you an example here. I'll go back to the PowerPoint so you can see them. These characters are considered glyphs, okay? Some will actually have pictures like hearts or faces or icons, and that's pretty neat. Oops. But we want to make sure that we understand what they are and how to appropriately use them. Okay, any questions? We've kind of come to a stopping point real quick. We'll continue on with the rest of the slides, and then what we're going to do is jump into our design. Does everyone have Illustrator pulled up? If not, go ahead and do that. All right. So using effects responsibly. So we talked a little bit about what not to do for the text. Three deadly weapons of design, and I wanted to share these with you because these are the don'ts, what not to do. Stroked fonts, never, ever, ever give your font a stroke. There's no need to do that. Very rarely, if you're trying to do that, then perhaps the background that you're putting your font on needs to be changed, because if you usually you put a stroke on a font to allow it to be a little bit more legible, but if you have to do that, then you're kind of cheapening your design a little bit. So stroke fonts are highly discouraged. Drop shadows, again, you don't need a drop shadow unless you're giving an actual shadow. You don't want text to have drop shadows. It's hard to read, especially large bodies of text. There's really no need to use them. Gradients, again, they have to be done tastefully, but you don't have to mess with it, okay? In fact, gradients are kind of outdated. They were they kind of trendy a while ago, and now they're just kind of not. So we're kind of discouraging gradients to be used, because some students think that they can use the whole rainbow in their gradient, and it really, again, it cheapens the design. So using effects responsibly, we were talking about drop shadows. So have a purpose for the shadow. Ask yourself, is this needed? Be consistent with your use in the same piece. So if you're going to use a drop shadow to emphasize something, use it throughout your piece to emphasize the same point. Take the time to get it right, though. Here's a way to adjust your drop shadow. I took a screenshot here. You can make specific adjustments depending on how wide you want your drop shadow, how blurry, how condensed. You could even adjust the size of it that on the X and Y axis, which direction you want your drop shadow to be facing. So you can adjust here. Does everyone know how to adjust or give something a drop shadow? Okay, good. I'll show you when we get into Illustrator. So let's talk about gradients real quick. So again, ask yourself, is the gradient needed? Now we see in some logos there are gradients, as long as they're tastefully done. And in this case, this has been using two different shades of blue. Okay, that blends nicely. But when you start adding blue, orange, green, pink, all the colors under the rainbow, it starts getting a little bit muddled and it doesn't have the same effect. It doesn't look very professional. It can't be replicated in all materials, so it's best used in digital applications. So if you're doing a design for the web, then perhaps maybe it might be good. But for print, it doesn't usually translate very well because it's really hard to capture those colors on print. So take the time to adjust if you need to. The general rule of thumb, again, is 2 or 3 max. So keep them closer on the color wheel, just like you see here. The two shades of blue, choose a direction, a consistent direction that you want to put it on, and just make sure that you don't go too crazy. Do you guys know how to, use a gradient? Okay, so everyone knows how to apply a gradient, good. Stroke fonts, I'm sure everybody knows how to add a stroked font. It's just putting color in your stroke box. Have a purpose for it. It does not work on small type. So anything above 16 or 20 points, you'll generally be safe. But when possible, use a font designed with a stroke. Don't make one yourself. It doesn't look right sometimes. It doesn't always translate. Consider the font you're using. Bold sans serif works best if you are going to add a stroke, like you see in this example. And adjust the position of the stroke to relate to the font. You can adjust the thickness of the stroke. So sometimes you don't need something very thick. And then consider the color combinations. In this case, I don't recommend the blue and the yellow, but it's just a good example. You want something that will definitely stand out though. text effects and distort. So there's text on a path, text warp, envelope, distort, vertical type. These are only to be used with skill and wisdom. So just like she showed you, the text on the path, just make sure that you are not going hog wild, basically. Just use them tastefully. All right. Let me see. Anything else? Okay, so this is your responsibility as a designer. What can happen if you don't pay attention to detail? Well, let's take a look. Let's see some designers' work in action. Okay, what do you see here? What do you notice about the headline? It all seems redundant. Have you read the headline? Packed with tasteless sugar. What does that mean? Yeah, there's no breaks, right? There's no commas. Packed with taste, comma, less sugar. Or packed with taste, period, less sugar, period. It's missing its punctuation, which doesn't read right. So it doesn't read correctly or how it should. That's right. What about this one? Yeah, I think this one goes with, yeah, this one goes without saying. Please pay attention to your spacing, definitely, exactly. I noticed this one first off, I was just like, wow, someone needs to give a little bit of space. That's so. And consistency, just like we see in the Harry Potter novels, everything's designed, the headlines are designed correctly, and then they add the title of the movie or the title of the book. And this creates some consistency. Sometimes it doesn't, but at least the logo is the same. Okay, what about this one? Yeah, but look at it closely. The oneth floor. It's repetitive, but the oneth floor, what about the tooth floor? Yeah, so again, it's not making sense because it's not correct grammar, right? How is that? Who knows how that is? I don't know how that even passed inspection. Yeah, it should be the first floor, the second floor, the third floor. Yeah, it's obviously someone was not awake enough when they were doing this. So again, it's very important that you have correct grammar and punctuation. Okay, let's talk about logic here. I can see what they're doing. I for information, N for department. Doesn't really make sense. Yeah, and they got paid. Okay, so this doesn't make sense. There is no sense here at all. At first you're like, oh, each letter is going to have a word that it represents, but when you get to N, it's almost unreadable, but it doesn't even make sense. So there is no logic here. Do another one. What about the positioning? Yikes is right. See, as designers, it's important to pay attention to where our placement of things are, spacing. It would have been nice if she was moved a little bit over, like kind of a little bit more to the right or to the left over the H so that you could get what that, I mean, I'm sure it says where. I think that's the title. It's whereoc.com, so Where OC Magazine. But because she's covering up the E, there is no way to tell what this should be. So there you go. Placement, people. It's all about spacing and placement. What about this one? Maybe a good idea gone wrong? Yeah, I'm sure, Tamara, she made some people very proud. What's wrong here? What do you think the designer was trying to do? Yeah, fruit for a letter didn't really translate, did it? Not so much. G for grapefruit. Nope. Didn't work. Yeah, it didn't even really look like a G, so I'm not quite sure what they were thinking there. Yep, didn't work. So as we can see, designer responsibility. This could happen to you, okay? This could be your design. So just be sure that we're aware of what we're doing and we're paying attention to the rules. Okay, let's start talking about our assignment. This is a fun part. Text illustrations. What's a text illustration? Can you tell me? Text, yes, you use text. Letters, characters, absolutely. It's an illustration that has been created solely out of text. Okay, you're making connections between the text and an illustration. So if you look at this art, these portraits, it's just strictly letters and characters in a font family. Can you see that? Yeah, illustrations, artwork with just text. So these are some pretty cool ones. Some are more obvious than others. So, I mean, it's important to just... So can illustrations aid learning of text material? Absolutely. Last week, you guys did a research paper on a font, a particular font family. Name your font family that you did research on. Baskerville, Dido, Arial, Helvetica, good. So it's good that you were able to explore a little bit this font family. So what you're going to do for this next assignment is you're actually going to take the font family that you did research on, and you're going to create some artwork out of it, okay? I believe you can pick any font family to do, but since you've already put the work in, then this is kind of just the easy part. So I'm going to show you. There's some examples. Let's look at another one. Look how artists have created art out of tilting. Yes, I heard someone say, so we can stretch it now. Yes, in this assignment, you can if it works. Sizes, styles, these create texture, value, and even depth. Okay. So you're going to go find an illustration, something that you want to mimic, or you can create your own. And you're going to submit this for your assignment 3. All right, that's what we're going to be doing. Here's another example. Just love this one. This one's cool. So just kind of to preface this assignment, most of this, like the one on the left, this one would be done in Photoshop. Typically, you'd often see text illustrations created in Photoshop because you can get a really cool effect. Really easily. Illustrator is not really the place for text illustrations, though it can be done. It's just not as easy as Photoshop. So while we'll be doing it in Illustrator, I'll be showing you just more of a simplified way of doing it, something that you can do quickly. In the discussion, I shared some really cool, I'll see if I can find it, share it real quick. The Star Wars typography, did you guys see those posters that I put in the discussion? Yeah, so I had one particular student, I think it was, is it Elizabeth? Was it you, Elizabeth, that did it? I had one particular student submit they actually tried it at home and it looked awesome. Yeah, good job, Liz. It looked really good. And I'll show you, let me pull up my internet. There it is. So I'll pull up Google here and kind of show you. So these were the posters that they did. If you look closely, it's just clearly it's just the type. Okay, they use the letter D for the hat. They use letter L, it looked like. Maybe they use the parentheses for the face or the mask. Lots of parentheses for the mask. Letters C, O. So they did lots of different, it looks like a different font family was used within here as well. Yoda, it's kind of cool. just really, really neat how they were able to capture the character just by using type alone. There's another one who's Darth Vader. This one's really cool. So these are text illustrations. They can be as simple as a Yoda or as complicated as, you know, something like this. Or let me find another one. This one's really cool. Something like this. Now, this effect would be done in Photoshop. Photoshop's a really cool place to do something like this. And we're not going to be doing Photoshop. Unfortunately, we can't work in Photoshop. But you can see by adjusting color, shading, the opacity of letters, you can get a really, really neat image here. So even just doing by a simple Google search, you'll find some pretty spectacular things. Some pretty incredible designers do some pretty neat work. So I'm actually going to grab one of these because we're going to do one in class. And it looks like we're just about up with our lecture portion of this assignment. So I wanted to share with you guys a few more, some work that students have done in the past. Sometimes I think it's easy. I don't know about you. I like seeing what other students do before you tackle an assignment. Some students prefer that just because you want to kind of see what's expected. Some of these aren't necessarily winners, and some of them are. So I'll let you decide. But I will pull. Pull this up. There we go. Now, Liz, it looks like you had already done these, so you're pretty good. I think you'll be good to go this week. It did. It did say to do a face. That's what the assignment wants. So we'll be doing a face. So here is one example. This is really cool. They did the queen. You can see they use the S's for the curls and the hair. Very neat. The J, the eyelashes. So just this assignment requires you to think outside the box a little bit to create art out of what you're given. And that's the characters. So here's a face. Pretty simple design. This was made out of the Futura font. Let me zoom out a little bit so that you can see it. This one was really neat. I really like this one. Mrs. Bodini. This one required a lot of thought and effort to create the curls in the hair, the nose. This was really well done. Futura, again, a face. Can you see the face? This one was pretty neat. Look hard. You see this one? This one was neat because it's got the piercings on the ear. I thought that was kind of cool. It's a side portrait. Yep, with a cup of coffee. Yep, there you go. So I really want you to get creative. Yeah, Alvin, absolutely. You can show it. Get yours ready. So there you go. As you can see, they're all created differently. There's all different kinds of versions. Some are simpler than others. This one's kind of cute. The braces. Love the hair. This one looks like a baby face, monkey face. Pretty simple. So challenge yourself to kind of think outside the box a little bit. This was neat how they did the top hat. So these are examples. Alvin wanted to share his, absolutely. So go ahead, Alvin, go ahead and share your screen. Let's take a look. Oh, very cool. Love it. Very, very nice. Now, what I would say, Alvin, this is really great. I would say try not to think of a way to create the hat, the outline of the hat, using just letters, though, because we can't use lines or shapes for this assignment. It has to be strictly the characters. But this is awesome. Very, very good job. Love it. Good job. See, did you have fun with it? I hope you had fun with it. All right, Liz, did you want to show yours? Good job, Alvin. Well done. All right, let's close out of here. Liz, go ahead and share yours. I like it. Very nice. Very nice. I like the glasses, the O, use the, it looked like a J or something. I liked how you used the little swoosh for the hair. Very cool. Very nice. Both of you, good job. So good job, Alvin and Liz. I appreciate you sharing that, kind of showing your fellow students kind of how you approach the assignment. That's always fun to see. Very, very nice job. Okay, so go ahead. We'll take our 10-minute break. So I'll share the whiteboard here. When I come back, we'll do our assignment. So if you can pull up Illustrator and kind of maybe search on Google to see if you can find any text illustrations that you'd like to copy. I'm going to use the, we'll start with the Star Wars. I'll show you two or three different versions depending on how much time we have. All right, thanks guys. All right, guys, so you ready to do the design portion of this class? You're welcome to follow along with me, though today I think I'm going to be moving at a pace where you'll probably just want to watch the first time around, and then we'll give you some time if you want to work on it. All right, so first things first, I usually go to Google and I find a typography illustration that I want to copy or mimic. So I pulled it into Illustrator, and then you can start kind of typing and creating. So I'll show you how I did that, how I did this effect. So what you want to do is place. So if you pull it into Photoshop, place it on your layer, name the layer. So it's your example layer. Then you want to lock it, create a new layer. And this will be your text layer. And you can kind of position it where you need it to be. And then once you have your text layer set, you can go back to your example layer and adjust the opacity. So by making it less, you can kind of see where the more transparent your image, the better off you're going to be able to see where your design lies, because it can kind of get busy. You want to even bring it down even more. Okay, so then what I'm going to do is kind of use this type on a path tool. That will help me create get the angles and the different direction of type. But first, there is something that we use, which is the pen tool. Have you guys used the pen tool before? Anybody? So the idea and some people, it's kind of a love-hate relationship with the pen tool, I think, because some people who aren't very seasoned designers find it very difficult to master or manipulate. So it's very hard to use sometimes, but I'm going to show you an easy way around it. Instead of using the pen tool and then typing on a path, you can get the same effect by using the pencil. So if you go down to your pencil tool, yeah, you can use it for drawing, but by using your pencil tool, this will allow you to kind of draw the line that you want. Once you've created the line, you can just simply get your smooth tool out and smooth out that line. Now, once you've smoothed it out, you can go to your type tool, your type on a path tool. And in this case, we're going to copy this font. Now, I found a font that I really like. And you can get a nice effect by making some letters smaller than others. And then I just gradually increase the size. I usually increase it by about two points. There we go. And that gives me a nice gradual effect, just like that. So another way around the pen tool for this assignment, if you don't have the time to master it, it's always good to try to learn it. But for this assignment, you can get around it by using the pencil tool. So by using the pencil tool, you'll just kind of trace where you want to go. If you want to smooth out the line, you can use your smooth tool. But then you'll just get your type on a path and click on it. Once you have typed in your text, I'm just kind of changing it to uppercase, and then I'm going to do the same thing, kind of the gradual look. And I'm just applying a 10 point, then I'm going 12 point, I'm going to go 15 point. 17 point. So this allows me to give some depth and dimension. And by doing that, I can give it the color. And it allows me to create something. And I'm also focused on my leading. I have a really tight leading here that will, if it's too spaced out, it doesn't quite give me the effect I'm looking for. And I'll zoom in so you can see it. I'm kind of bringing in my kerning a little bit. So I want to create a really dramatic eyebrow. So I'm able to control the leading a little bit. Even with the leading here, I can kind of bring it in. And for these assignments, you don't necessarily have to have a legible text, but you definitely want to make sure that you pay attention to your spacing, okay? So this is one way that you can create something. There's another one I wanted to show you. Create a new one. Pay attention to your assignment as far as the the correct dimensions and everything. You want to make sure you have that laid out correctly. I'm going to throw this Star Wars poster in because I thought this was really cool, and these are a little bit more simplified. That's a good question, Alvin. Let me double check that for you. I don't want to tell you wrong, so let me pull up the assignment. And you can even pull up your homepage too to check. So why don't you go with me on that? We'll go together and we'll look at the class assignment and see. Specific dimensions are there too. And the grading rubric will be up there. So if you have any questions on what you're going to be graded on, just check the grading rubric. So I'm going to go there now and see what the answer to your question would be. It's a good question. I heard it both ways. So I don't care as long as it works. I mean, I would say don't worry about sticking to one. It says choose a font from the approved list, create an illustrator. So yeah, I guess the idea is to capture the character of the person with just using the font family. Now, I think you can pick any font on the approved list, or you can do the one that you did research on. It's up to you. So we'll say one font family. So yes, you'll have to. Yeah, absolutely, Tamara. You can definitely do the Star Wars for the assignment. I definitely recommend you trying to challenge yourself a little bit, but this counts too. So let me show you. I've got this pulled into layer one, which is my example layer. So you want to set up your example layer, create a new layer. This is going to be your text layer. Now, test layer. Before you lock your example layer, you want to make sure that you adjust the opacity on it, because it won't let you do it once you lock it. So we're going to bring it down, select it, bring the opacity down quite a bit so that you can see it, then lock it. And now you can use, go to your text layer. Now you'll be able to create your characters. So we'll do the ears. Now, once you've created, I'm using Myriad Pro. For these ones, I believe Star Wars did different font families, but so you'll have to adjust for that. Once I've gotten the size, roughly the size I want, I'm gonna go to Type, Create Outlines. This will allow me to individually manipulate it so it fits. Stretched out a little bit, it's even kind of tilted. So you'll need to get it just right, but kind of match it. Hold down Shift and Option to enlarge it. There you go. And then I'm just going to make a duplicate copy of that same one. Holding down Alt Option will allow you to change. You see that double mouse? That means that you can make a copy of it by clicking and dragging. So yeah, Tamara, you can do this as your assignments. Now I've got the ears placed. It's a pretty simple way to do it. The parentheses, these don't, this particular image uses fewer characters. And again, I'm going to go to create outlines. Now, it looks like they're using a serif font to create the eyebrows, but in this case, we have to use one font family, so I'm just going to try my best to get as close as I can. I'm holding down Alt Option, clicking and dragging. This allows me to make a duplicate copy, and then I can resize it. Kind of want to check the positioning of the eyebrow a little bit. Now the key is to get the angle just right. So you want to make the proportion just right and the angle just right. And with this one, this will be an easy one because you just copy each one and then rotate it and adjust the size for it. Now this is more of a bolder font, so this wouldn't work. You'd probably want to choose something from the list that had more of a narrow font. Because I don't think it's going to translate as well. This definitely needs to be more of a narrower font. He's not looking too Yoda-y, so he's going to require a little bit of manipulation. And then another one, and then I'll just rotate it. So what this assignment is doing is hopefully it's going to teach you to think a little bit outside the box, try to be creative, try to problem solve. How do I get that effect by using just the characters that I'm limited to? And you can even grab anchor points if you need to get really accurate. I'm going to zoom in here, hold down Shift. You can kind of manipulate these little anchor points with the direct selection tool. There we go. Here we go. Can manipulate the anchor points so that they position just correct, just right. So it'll take some practice, it'll take some time. Even now I'm kind of trying to work with how I can get this to fill in my gaps. There we go. So zoom in really close, try to get that overall layout. It's starting to come together. And hopefully while I'm doing this, you're kind of already getting some inspiration on what you want to do for yours. Again, I need to angle these just right. But this is actually a really fun assignment. You'll start to see your assignment come to life a little bit, and it gets exciting to see. All right, and then one more parentheses, but this one's gonna get rotated around. Here, kind of stretch this out a little bit. And then rotate it. Are there any questions so far? What I would suggest to you would be to go onto Google and find an image that you would like to create, you can either do this and trace it, or you can try to come up with your own. But by going to type, create outlines, this does allow you to do some manipulation. So like with the nose, this D needs to be manipulated just slightly. So yes, you can break the rules on this assignment because you're supposed to be creating art, and art sometimes requires you to have to do that. So Liz, you've decided you're going to do another one, and Alvin, you're going to change what you've done, huh? I think the more practice, the better in this case. So again, make sure you create outlines when you're doing this. This will definitely help get rid of those text boxes and make life just a little bit easier for you. There you go. And then last but not least, the line. That's a character on my keyboard. So I'm not drawing a line. I'm using the character in the character family. I'm being resourceful. And this will be his mouth. There you go. So it's not perfect, but there it is. And by hiding my example now, there is my Yoda. So it kind of looks like him. Not bad. So you think so you're asking, can you use the character above the 9 or the 0? I can't use the character above the 8. You'll have to show me your assignment again. Are you talking about the hat, Alvin? The hat that you... So you didn't use the pen tool or the line tool, that was just the character? Okay, so yeah, you can use any character on the keyboard, just no pen tool or line tool or shape tools. So if you created that hat, so my apologies, if you created that hat just using characters, that totally goes. So good job. Good question. And thanks for clarifying. So yeah, I created this line out of the character on my keyboard in the character font family. I didn't use my line tool. I didn't use shape tools for this. So just avoid the toolbar in this case. And just use what's on your keyboard, the type characters. But yes, very good. And then to also show you, there is a place where you can get glyphs. So if you go to type and go to the glyphs right here, go to your type drop-down menu, select glyphs. You'll see that in my particular font family, I'm in Myriad Pro right now, but depending on what font family you're in, there might be more, there might be less. There's tons of these characters. So you're not just limited to what you see on the keyboard. There's all these hidden characters too. So you could probably get really creative using some of these. Like this one already is kind of like a hat. You know, it's already kind of formed. That's kind of cool. There's even shapes in here, triangle. So to use one, you just simply double click and it will pull it into your text box. There's quite a bit. There's some really neat characters that are unusual that you could probably come up with some pretty clever uses for. So try to use your glyphs if you're stuck and you're trying to figure out what to use. So in this case, I'm not super loving his eyes. I might go with a different character for his eyes. So I would probably look in my glyphs. This is kind of like your library of additional characters to use. So that's another place where you can find him. All right. Any questions about this one? All right, so there's that one. And I'm going to go back to this one, and I want to show you kind of how we got this. Now, you'll see some letters. Oh, that's another thing, is there's some effects where you can see. Let's do S and C and O. I'm gonna go to type, create outlines. You can create hair, If you want curls, just pick curly letters, create outlines, and then I'm going to ungroup these. One student just copied the S's over and over. S's, even the O's make for good curls. And use different sizes too. This will give you a really cool effect. And this is without tracing, so you can create some hair, kind of scatter, like we saw in that example that I shared with you. And then you can even copy the group over. So this could be my hair. By using different letters, it gives you a really nice inconsistent look and it makes it look a little bit more detailed. And I kind of like that. I'm kind of strategically placing things. All right, so once you have your hair, then you can start creating eyes. So that's another way to create like the curly hair if you were wanting to do it. This is another one I wanted to finish with you. There's by using different size letters, going increasing and then decreasing, that can create some dimension there. To create these little scattered letters, you kind of have to draw a few individually and then you can kind of group them, scatter them around, then shrink them down. Grab another group of letters, copy them, shrink them down. And you kind of just want to position them. Position where you think they need to go and they can go and delete. You can always go and delete to create the, clean up the area that you want. All right, so by using large and small, it gives me some dimension. And it can also create shading too. Shading is an important thing. You want to make some emphasis. All right, so now I'm going to go in here. Got to grab my pencil tool like I showed you guys. There it is. And I'm just going to trace. And if your line isn't smooth enough, you can grab your smooth tool and I'll show you what it does. Once you draw, and it never hurts to zoom in, you can kind of trace over it and it will kind of smooth out those edges for you. I'm going to grab this text right here. I'm going to grab my type on a path tool, click and paste, and now I'm going to make sure that the text is increased here a bit. I don't want it that increased. Let's try 20. And I'm going to create outlines in this case. I'll get the fonts. Go 13, 12, 10. $12, $15, $17, So I'm adjusting the sizes about 2 points different. Make it pink, and then by creating outlines, it will allow me to manipulate some of these letters. So you can see there's some kind of a, some of them are a little like this B here. Let me show you. This B has kind of a neat effect on it. It looks like it's stretched. So I'm going to go to type, create outlines, ungroup so that I can move them individually. I'm going to grab this B. I can kind of manipulate it. I'm going to grab my direct selection tool. This will also allow me to make some alterations. Like that. Can make something stretch, can make them more narrow. So instead of using the the type size in your character font control panels, you can kind of just do create outlines and then reshape the letters to match what you're designing, which might be easier. This will be a lot more accurate. Just like that. Any questions about this design? How you get this effect? What you do? Okay, it's pretty straightforward. So I hope you have some fun. I'm gonna give you guys a few minutes to practice, pick a picture and try to practice something. Maybe start as simple as the Star Wars typography. While I am manipulating this one. And then we're gonna go explore Google just for a minute, and I'm gonna show you how to find a typographic illustration that you can either copy or kind of use as inspiration. And then I think I have one more video for you guys to watch. Anyways, this kind of creates a really neat dimension. Kind of you can manipulate letters and it will give you a neat effect. This one actually is a lot of fun. And then you can see these sporadic letters that you'll kind of have to type out yourself. But these do take time, but it gives you a really neat effect. All right, so let me stop the share here. We'll go to Google. Type in Google. And then I'm going to typographic illustration. So I showed you some examples, but there are tons more. Let's see if I can find one. Find one that you would be, let's do simple. Simple typographic. This is not very simple, but it's really cool. Doing something like that. What about this one? Kind of neat. I'm telling you, there are some talented artists out there. Can't see it? Let's see. Oh, I apologize. Let's try it. Try that. Can you see it now? Thank you for letting me know. So what I want you to do is kind of look on the internet. I'm going to give you about 2 or 3 minutes to find a picture that you would like to try. Maybe inspiration for your assignment. Maybe this is just going to get you looking, get you excited about what we're doing. So you're going to have 2 or 3 minutes to kind of look on Google, find something. It could be as simple as the Star Wars thing if that's what you want to go with. Or you can find something online. This is pretty neat how they did the portrait. They captured the face. This is more of a minimalist approach, but still very, very neat. All right. So we'll give you 2 minutes. Go ahead and find something. I want you to either share it if you feel like you want to. Or not, but this would be a good way to just kind of get a head start on the assignment. So go ahead and do that, and I'm going to pull up our video that we're going to be watching. All right, has anyone found anything? Anything to kind of help speed your design along? No problem, take your time. I'm actually gonna show a video, so while you're looking on Google, you can kind of listen. This one is about design principles that I really think that we need to kind of get a good handle on. So let me pull this up, and as you're looking for a picture for inspiration, just listen and kind of take a listen to the basic design principles. This is a focus on type use in design. Sound okay?
It's always a good idea to review basic design principles when you're working with not only typography, but basically anything that you use in graphic design, such as imagery or graphic shapes. In this case, I'm going to focus more on the use of typography as they work with these basic design principles. So I'm going to give you a simple example of each of these nine principles and how you can think about them when you're working with your text layouts. They are, of course, unity, variety, balance, rhythm, emphasis or focal point, contrast, breathing room or sometimes called negative or white space, proportion and scale. The first one I'm going to show is unity. And I have very simple shapes here and I have some Greeking text to show you examples of how a layout can bring together disparate elements to become unified. And what's working here as far as the layout goes is the way that these elements are aligned. That's what brings these into good unity. Of course, I'm using the same typeface throughout the piece and that also adds to unity. But I'm pulling these ruler guides down here to show you how different elements are aligned on this piece here. And the most important ones are the four margins around the edges. The title and the left side of the paragraph here and the left side of this gray bar, which could be a photograph or it could be just a basic shape, really serve to bring it together because they're aligned nicely. You can see that there's alignment on the bottom and on the right as well. Now, the darker gray square here is, it's the top of it is aligned with the baseline of the word unity, the title, but you could also extend it to the top of this gray, lighter gray square if you wanted to align it with the top of the title. So you do have a little leeway there. But regardless of which you choose, the fact that these are aligned really tightly and nicely serve to give it a good unity and working well together. We can even get away with not having a straight edge on this paragraph. There's a ragged edge here, and that's okay because the outside elements are nicely and tightly lined up and serve to work well together. So that is one way you can have make unity work in your favor. Variety is another design principle, and these gray squares could indicate paragraphs of text. They could be text or imagery, whatever. But the thing that stands out, of course, is the variety of that red shape in the layout there. Now, that could be text set in a different color. It could be a red bar with, say, white text inside of it to be a variety, give variety to the layout of black text on a white background, for instance. It could also be a nice way to separate this third rectangle on the right from the other two on the left. Sometimes you have a separate piece of text which is a different topic and you want to separate it from the others yet still take up the same amount of space. So putting a variety element in there like a different color or a different font, something to break it up, gives visual interest to the page. And you'll get the hang of how to work with variety the more that you do it. A lot of these things take some time to develop, but the more you practice with them, the easier they will become, and you'll start to see ways to make them happen. balance is the next principle here. And you'll notice that I have a series of rectangles on this page. Again, they could be text, they could be a combination of text and imagery, but they're illustrated here by the color that I've set these in. The largest rectangle is the lightest color. Okay, but it is balanced by the smaller rectangle because the smaller one is a darker color. So even though the larger one is bigger, it still balances nicely because it's lighter, but it balances the smaller one quite well. Then we have the third element of the green repeated squares on top of the rectangle on the right there. And these are much brighter than the others, yet they're the smallest. So because they're brighter, their small size helps keep them in balance. So keep in mind that color and size can work to your benefit when you're trying to balance things. You can have something larger and it can be lighter, and the smaller element can be darker or brighter, and you'll get a good balance that way. And of course, alignment always helps to achieve the unity and also helps with a sense of balance. Rhythm is the next principle. Now, rhythm, here's a secret. The way to get a good sense of rhythm in any element you use, whether it be visual or typographic, is repetition. Repetition is what creates the rhythm, okay? And I have repetition in each of these two words here. The word sail is repeated 5 times in different colors, different tones, so that it sets up a fairly smooth rhythm, but there's a progression there. It almost seems like you start out shouting the word sail, and then you speak it, and then you whisper it, because it gets lighter. But the font stays the same, the size, the spacing, everything stays the same, except the color. But the repetition is key to setting up the rhythm. And this is a fairly smooth rhythm. Now, the word go on the right is a little different. There's some nice unity there because I've kept the same font and, of course, the same word, but I've changed the scaling, the color, and the angles at which these three words have been set. So the rhythm that's been set up here is more staccato, more jumpy, a little more active than the other one, but it still remains readable. And notice that I made this smallest word go the brightest color, again for balance. So we have a smooth piece of rhythm and we have a more jumpy staccato, syncopated rhythm there, which sends a message. But rhythm equals repetition, or repetition creates rhythm. So keep that in mind when you're trying for a rhythmic feeling to your layouts. Now, every good design needs to have a focal point or a point of emphasis. Here is a really simple example of what a focal point can be. And in this case, it's the large letter T. If that gray shape there was a paragraph of text, the eye would go to the green T, because if the text were black on a white background, our eye goes to the scale of the T and also to the fact that it's in color. And also, our eye tends to go to the upper left of a layout generally first. So we're going to look there first. We tend to read from left to right and from top to bottom. And we look at things that way too, most generally. So if you want to emphasize something, one way to do it will be to place it in that position. Now, here we also have a secondary focal point, and that is this yellow rectangle over here. It relates to this one because it's the same yellow, but it's not quite as bright because there's nothing going on in it. This could be a yellow rectangle with black text in it to balance the other piece and relate to it, but still be distinctive and set apart. So we have a major focal point, primary focal point, and then the secondary focal point here. And in this case, it's using color, and here it's using color and scale. Next is contrast. And for this example, I'm using something called text color. Text color is nothing to do with the color of the text. It is the way that the text is spaced. And you can see in this type sample that the way these different paragraphs have been spaced creates really interesting and varied text color. The larger font paragraphs look actually lighter than the others because they're much more widely spaced. And it sets up a very nice contrast look, and it's much more interesting on a page than if everything were the same font and spacing and sizing. Sometimes you can't avoid that. Sometimes you have to set things in a consistent manner because it's, you know, consistency is really important. But if you had the option with several different topics on a page, for example, and you wanted to break up the text to make it interesting, consider working with your text color, which is basically your spacing and your sizing, to create different effects. And the contrast really is nice. It gives the eye some place to travel, gives the eye focal points, and it's much more interesting to look at than all the same plain gray text. Now we have breathing room, or sometimes called negative or white space. And I had some fun with this phrase, let me breathe, by tracking it super tight. The letters are touching and it looks like it's suffocating here. You can read it, but it's actually a pretty good illustration of the phrase because it's hard for it to breathe. It doesn't have enough room. So I increased the tracking, put quite a bit of space in between the letters, and it's like, ah, sigh of relief. So generally speaking, you want to have sufficient spacing between your letters. Also remember that you want to have good room around your titles, good room around any graphics or anything on your page, especially with margins. Once in a while you can bleed something off the edge, but generally speaking we go for nice breathing room. Okay, now what's happening over here with this green rectangle? It might look fine. The text looks fairly readable. There's nothing really bad going on here, but it is a no-no, and here is why. If you have a colored text box, your text goes all the way to the edge of the text box, it is too tight. Okay, even though there's breathing room around it with this white, it's right up to the edge of the green, and that's too tight. So that is a no-no. How do you fix that? In InDesign, you go to the object drop-down menu, you select your text frame, you go to the object drop-down, text frame options, and then you change your inset spacing, you increase it, and the text will pop in to the box a little bit, and it will make a nice margin around the text. So you have to have breathing room for all your text, regardless of where it is sitting on the page. So do keep that in mind. Lastly, we have proportion and scale. Here we have a sense of a disproportionate layout here. The headline is way too big for the elements, and the little boxes here are just not the right size for the headline, and all this space over here is empty. It looks very top heavy. Okay, so we need to change the scaling to make things more proportional. And so over here, this has been achieved. The word headline has been sized so that it is exactly the width of the two gray square rectangles, which would be, say, pieces of text or paragraphs of text. The headline sits nicely atop each of them. And then these little magenta rectangles can be images. They might be overlapped. They might be
Okay, we're going to stop it there. There's only about a minute left. But for sake of time, we're going to make sure that we wrap up here. Have you guys got any inspiration for the assignment? I saw that Alvin wants to do a self-portrait. That's pretty cool. Alvin, I can't wait to see that. That would be neat. There's a lot of designers that have done themselves. They've actually taken pictures, then done a black and white version. You can do a grayscale version in Illustrator to try to do it. Let me show you real quick if you'd like. Let me stop the share. We'll pull up Illustrator. Share screen. Okay, so pretend that this was I'll hide this layer and bring this back at 100% opacity. So pretend you took a picture of yourself. You can go to your image trace and this little arrow here, go to shades of gray. And it will convert it into a black and white or grayscale for you. So as you do your image, then you'll kind of have to figure out where you want to group your text to create the shadowing and the dimensions. So you'll probably have to simplify it a little bit, but by doing that, that should help you eliminate the color because the color can be distracting when it comes to how you're going to trace your portrait. Are there any questions? The video touched on rhythm, unity, let's see what else, proximity, it talks about spacing. This is the grayscale version, so you could kind of see
So we just need to be conscious and be aware of the design principles that we're learning, because we want to apply them, and it still applies even in this assignment 3. All right, and Liz, you have something to share? Sure, let's see it. Go for it. And this will probably wrap up our lecture for today. Now that is very cool. Love it, Liz. So great. So great. So let's see, what font are you using? That looks like you went above and beyond, because you did the whole full body. You didn't just do the portrait, did you? It's kind of a Marilyn Monroe. Love it. I love the wispy kind of font that you did. Let's see. You pulled up your character. Zaffino, is that what it is? Very, very nice. Love it. I think this is perfect. So granted, anyone watching from, you don't have to do a full body shot. The assignment just calls for the portrait, but Liz, I think this is spectacular. Excellent job. And Alvin, very good job on your getting that head start on your assignment. I can't wait to see what you guys turn in. Are there any questions regarding the assignment? Anything coming up? Make sure to make your post by tomorrow before midnight, your initial post. Make sure you keep an eye out on the word count too, because some students kind of lost points based off of the word count. We are monitoring that, so we want to make sure that everyone's posting a good full-length post with citing AP sources. Okay? All right, can't wait to see what you guys turn in. This is a really fun assignment. I had fun teaching it. I can't wait to grade it, so I hope you guys have fun designing it. Liz, that's an excellent job. Appreciate you guys putting in the effort. Yeah, for the assessment, good question. So let's go look at the assessment real quick. Let me pull up my Google Chrome. We'll take a look at it real quick. So what specific question did you have about the assessment? You just want kind of a summary of what you're doing? Yeah, okay. So the assessment is based off of pattern making. Now they tell us as instructors not to kind of step you through too much of the assignment, because we want you guys to try to do it on your own. You're basically going to create a new document. You're going to have 4 or 5 inch square art boards, create a different shape using one or a combination of two. You're going to be using drawing tools for the assessment, so that's good. You get to try to use them. Use the pattern making tool, fill each art board with a custom pattern, compress the shapes, drawing tools that you use. Okay, so let me see if I can find. We did this in another class and it actually worked out really well, but I'll show you a little bit about how to create patterns. Pretty simple. I actually have an Illustrator. Ooh, I wonder if I can find it. Let me see. Let me do a quick search on my computer real quick and see if I can find it, because there's an actual template that you can use. Was that for Design 103? Yeah. I'll look and see if I can find it. If I find it, I will post it in the announcements. I know I've got it somewhere. Pretty sure I just taught that class too. So it's in here. Let me look, do a quick search. If not, I'll do a quick, there we go, patterns, let's see. So I'll have to find the actual Illustrator document. It's a little template that I posted for some students in a previous class. I no promises that I can find it though, because I should have it laying around. I'll have to go dig for it. But what I'll do is I'll show you how you create a pattern so that you know how to do this. So you'll set up your 5-inch square art boards. Then let's see. What do they want you to do? Using the pattern making tool, fill each artboard with a custom pattern. Perfect. Okay. So we'll stop share and I'll show you how to do that. So you'll have 5 artboards, not just one. But this is what you do. You'll make sure you have your swatches box up and handy, and you're going to create your, you can either create your own. So I'll draw off different boxes here so that you can see. No fill. Now, a pattern can be anything. It can be shapes. Like this. So this could be my pattern, just like that. This will be my pattern. And then you just drag it in. And so as you can see, it's kind of hard. I can't zoom into the swatches, but my pattern is right here. So by creating a pattern, I just highlight all the elements and drag it in. So now it's created a pattern. So now I can draw a shape and fill it with my pattern. And now it becomes this patterned object. So if I want to go edit my pattern, I just double click on the little icon within the swatches panel, and I can go and move things around. Like I can delete a square, I can move a square, anything that's outside of this black box though. It's become a circle now. I can, anything that I alter within this black square will alter the entire pattern. You can even go and change when you bring up the pattern options. You can change the pattern grid, how you want it to look, brick by row, or you can do hex by column. Lots of different layouts for your pattern. Size tile to art, or move tile within art. You can overlap, copies. There's lots of different options you have. Brick offset, you smaller, you can do wider. So you can adjust, you can kind of customize this as you want. And that's how you edit a pattern. So then when you make an edit, kind of click off of the page a little bit. So any changes that you made will adjust your pattern now. Does that help? Oh, sorry guys. Am I in the wrong class? I was gonna say, pretty sure we just went over this. Okay, wow, wasted time, so sorry. This website defaults. Okay, then you tell me, what is the assessment? Well, I'm pulling it up, 113. Why does it do that? Whew, well, you just got a lesson in patterns. Let's try this again. Oh yeah, so the typesetting body copy. So we just went over a couple of videos on how to do this. So you're gonna practice your typesetting skills. We're gonna use remember we went over the 19 rules of typography today. We went over quite a few of them. And it's the same thing that you did in week one, where you had a document, you had some copy, and you have to create certain headlines, title, paragraph styles. And so just read it. It's pretty self-explanatory. You will be doing this in InDesign. I believe it's in InDesign. Yep, InDesign document. So same thing you did during week one. Sorry, guys. My bad. But now, can you create a pattern? Yes, we can all create a pattern. So not wasted time, right? Use patterns. Yeah, typesetting body copy. If you did week one, go back to week one. We talked about this, the videos. We even went over this during the videos today. So I'm not going to kind of rehash how to typeset. If you have specific questions, we can go over it. Come on Thursday, though, if you have any, you're completely lost. But it's pretty self-explanatory. It's not very long, the instructions. Actually, there's only three things you're graded on. And it's basically, did you do the assignment? So this doesn't require a whole lot of explanation, but come on Thursday if you have any questions. Sorry, Alvin. Thank you. All right. That is it on class time. We are out of time. So come visit me on Thursday for the multi-session if you guys want to get passed off on an assignment or if you guys need any help. You guys have been great. Thanks. Thanks for listening to my rant on patterns. See you guys later.